A recent study showed an association between snoring and infertility. Women that reported snoring had worse IVF outcomes and an increased risk of miscarriage. We will review this study and its implications in detail, and I will leave you with valuable tips to improve your sleep. I'm Dr. Lora Shahine. I'm a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist helping people with fertility and IVF for over 20 years. I love educating. I'm so glad that you found this channel. Be sure and subscribe so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. There are two other ways to stay in touch. Number one, my weekly podcast. There's a playlist here on YouTube. You can find it. You can listen anywhere you listen to podcasts, Apple, Spotify, anywhere. And I love interviewing people, fertility warriors, and doing deep dive information into topics. Another way to stay in touch is to subscribe to my newsletter, where you get links to educational content as well as recommendations from me. Struggling with infertility is tough. If you are, you are not alone. One in six couples trying to have a baby really struggle with infertility. When we're doing an evaluation for infertility, we think about anatomy and egg quality and sperm quality, but we don't often ask about snoring, and maybe we should. Today, we're going to go over five main topics. Number one, we're going to review this study on snoring and infertility and IVF outcomes and really explain what they found. Topic number two, we're going to go over snoring. Make sure you understand the definition and its implications. Number three, we're going to go over the importance of overall sleep with or without snoring and just how important sleep is for your reproductive health. Topic number four, I'm going to help you learn how to know if you're snoring or not. And topic number five, I'm going to give you valuable tips to help your sleep, decrease your snoring, and know what the next steps can be. Topic number one, let's review the study that inspired this topic of discussion today. This is a study conducted in China. It was looking at lots of different parameters for fertility and women undergoing IVF. The purpose of this particular study was to explore the possible contributors of outcomes of IVF, and a specific thing that they look at was the frequency of snoring. The study included 632 women age 24 to 45 diagnosed with infertility, which means trying for over 12 regular menstrual cycles without success. The women were given a questionnaire that asked a lot about lifestyle optimizations and habits, including snoring. They were undergoing their first IVF cycle in Peking from January 2018 through November 2021. A total of 579 patients were included in this particular question and study all about snoring. So what did they find? Overall, 42.3% or 245 patients reported snoring, with 33.5% or a total of 194 patients reporting occasional snoring, and 8.8% or almost 9% of patients saying they had frequent snoring. Patients that reported snoring had a significantly higher body mass index, higher cholesterol, and higher basal insulin levels. The researchers looked at the outcome of IVF cycles and divided it in from patients who reported snoring, who did not report snoring. And for the women that reported snoring, there were lower estradiol levels in their IVF cycle. There were fewer number of retrieved eggs. There were fewer metaphase II eggs. These are mature eggs. There were fewer fertilized eggs. And finally, there were fewer blastocysts created. And blastocysts are mature embryos, about 100 to 200 cells. These are the embryos that we either transfer or freeze. For pregnancy-related outcomes, the researchers showed that there was no difference in chance of a positive pregnancy test after embryo transfer related to snoring or not snoring. But for the patients that reported snoring, there was a higher chance of a biochemical miscarriage. A biochemical miscarriage is positive pregnancy test followed by a dropping beta HCG level. So implantation happened, but the pregnancy did not continue. And this is called a biochemical miscarriage. Of the 551 participants in this analysis, 34 had a biochemical miscarriage. Sub-analysis showed that the frequency of snoring was associated to an even higher risk of biochemical miscarriage, about a 14.6% risk of biochemical miscarriage with snoring versus about a 4.8% risk of biochemical miscarriage without snoring. And this is significant with a p-value of less than 0.5. Now, this is just one study, but I think it's very interesting and I want to kind of think about the why behind it. Topic number two, why would snoring impact fertility anyways? The authors argue that it's really obstructive sleep apnea that is related to hormonal changes, reproductive health, and increased risk of miscarriage. And snoring is a sign of obstructive sleep apnea. Obstructive sleep apnea is a sleep disorder. This is when someone actually stops breathing in the middle of the night because their airway is obstructed. They're lying down, they're comfortable, they're relaxed, and their airway is actually closing off for a minute, and they might not feel like they're waking up, but their body is waking them up and disrupting sleep in order to open up that airway so they can get oxygen. Obstructive sleep apnea has been shown in multiple studies to disrupt reproductive health. Obstructive sleep apnea has been associated with irregular ovulation, irregular periods, and a longer time to conception or infertility. Unfortunately, obstructive sleep apnea can go undiagnosed for a long time. It's kind of cumbersome and difficult to diagnose. It usually requires a sleep study where someone is observed in a sleep lab and watching them to see if they're stopping breathing and sort of waking themselves up. There are at-home monitors that you can get from your primary care doctor or sleep doctor, hook up when you get home and try to sleep at home and sort of try to diagnose and review that data to see if it's happening. So you can either do it in a sleep lab or try to do monitoring at home, but it requires multiple steps. And a lot of people just do not realize that this is happening. And 90% of people with obstructive sleep apnea will report a history of snoring. Topic number three, what about sleep and fertility? What's going on? What's this link? Well, sleep is essential for your overall health and well-being. I have covered this topic in another detailed video on YouTube. Called Sleep and Fertility. I encourage you to look at that video too to keep learning. In preparing for this deep dive in snoring and fertility, I found another wonderful review piece on the importance of sleep and fertility, and I will link it here in the description so you can find it yourself. The authors really go through studies and kind of talk about how essential sleep is for fertility and your overall reproductive health. The association of sleep and fertility is largely associated by molecular, genetic, and hormonal pathways in our body. These are crucial for complex communication and reproductive health, such as recruiting an egg, maturing an egg, ovulating, making hormones to allow for implantation, and conceiving. And pathologic sleep disturbances, such as obstructive sleep apnea, can be associated with multiple problems with reproductive health, including menstrual irregularity, polycystic ovarian syndrome, premature ovarian insufficiency, sub or infertility, and early pregnancy loss. As we saw in this most recent study that we covered closely, this review study also recognizes that success with IVF is often impacted by sleep quality. Topic number four, how do you know if you snore? I've got five tips for you. Number one, if you sleep with a partner, ask. Or if you have a family member or a roommate, ask them to let you know if they happen to hear you snoring in the middle of the night. If that doesn't work, if you don't have a partner, that person, is a deep sleeper and just has no idea. Option number two is to get a sleep app or monitor. There are recording apps called Snore Lab or Sleep Cycle or Snore Clock that you can download to your phone and kind of record while you're sleeping, and they can let you know if they hear snoring. A third option is to just record yourself while you're sleeping. The apps make it easy because they look for different sounds and they can tell you how many times you snored, et cetera. But just the basics, record either on your phone or with another type of recording device and just listen. And the fourth tip is to look for daytime symptoms of poor sleep or disrupted sleep. This can be real difficulty getting up in the morning, grogginess or fatigue throughout the day. You can also look for dry throat because your mouth is open. You've been trying to kind of get more air at night, headache, or just in general, just not feeling well, waking up not feeling rested. Tip number five is to get a sleep study or get an at-home monitor to screen for obstructive sleep apnea. This will require working with your primary care doctor or maybe a sleep specialist. I'm glad you stuck around. We're going to get to the fifth topic. So far, we have learned how important sleep is for reproductive health. We've learned that obstructive sleep apnea or, waking up or losing oxygen while you're trying to sleep can impact hormone levels, ovulation, infertility, increased risk of miscarriage. And we've learned that snoring can be a reliable sign of obstructive sleep apnea. Not always, but the majority of the time. So we've also learned tips on how to figure out if you're snoring. And now finally, topic number five, what do you do if you are snoring? What can you do to improve your sleep and improve your reproductive health? I've got some tips. I think about it as lifestyle optimization, sleep hygiene, some tools that you might be able to use in your bedroom to help with sleep, and then finally, when to see a doctor. So as far as lifestyle optimization, try sleeping on your side. If you are overweight, sometimes that can be associated with an increased risk of obstructive sleep apnea, and losing weight in a healthy way might improve your sleep. Not always, but it's something to talk to your doctor about. You can avoid alcohol and sedatives, especially in the evening as you're getting ready to sleep. Sometimes people think, oh, alcohol is a sedative and it can help me, you know, I fall asleep faster, but it usually disrupts sleep and it can worsen obstructive sleep apnea. Next, sleep hygiene. So what does that mean? That means creating an environment and a bedtime routine that is going to improve your overall sleep quality. And here are some tips. Number one, stick to a consistent schedule. Even on the weekends, try to go to bed at the same time each night and try to wake up at the same time each morning. When we are changing our schedule, that can throw off our pattern and our routine. So try to stick to a schedule. Number two, create a relaxing bedtime routine. This could be winding down a little bit in the evening, some little gentle stretching, a little bit of yoga, maybe reading a little bit. Find your consistent bedtime routine that just signals to your body and your mind that it is time to wind down. We are getting ready to fall asleep. Number three, limit screen time before bed. So screen time is stimulating our brain. It kind of gets us excited, especially, you know, with the way social media is and kind of fast, quick TikToks and reels and YouTube shorts. This can really be stimulating. So try and turn off your screen a minimum 30 minutes before you're going to try to go to bed. Number four, keep your bedroom cool and dark. Make it a quiet place, lower temperature, blackout shades, an eye mask. Cool, dark, restful, quiet place is where you want to try to go to sleep. Tip number five, avoid caffeine in the afternoon. This stimulant can stick in your system for hours. So really try to decrease caffeine intake after lunchtime. Tip number six, get sunshine. So sunshine, out for a walk, getting, you know, sun exposure during the day actually helps with our routine and stimulates our ability to quiet in the evening. And finally, stay active, you know, exercise, but not right before you go to bed. I mean, gentle stretching and yoga is wonderful, but increasing your heart rate or doing a really hard workout right before you're trying to go to bed can actually keep us stimulated and awake and active for a couple of hours. So you want to have a more of a strenuous workout earlier in your day. Some environmental adjustments or tools that you can use in your bedroom. Number one, consider a humidifier. Number two, consider pillows that help elevate your head. And number three, you can think about getting nasal strips or dilators that help open up your nasal passages to allow for better airflow. And the next category is when to see a doctor. So there are sleep specialists. There are doctors that help with improving airway, like an ear, nose, and throat doctor. Sometimes people will have surgical interventions to help with the airway. There are some oral appliances that some dentists can suggest, or sleep specialists and dentists. And there are something called CPAP machines that can really help push air into your airways when it senses that you are obstructing. So in summary, we have learned so much today. I really hope that you've found this to be valuable. We have learned how important sleep is for our reproductive health. We've learned that snoring can be a sign of obstructive sleep apnea and how this can impact so much of our wellness. We've learned tips on how to figure out if you're snoring, and we've learned tips to improve your sleep, whether you're snoring or not. I hope that this was helpful. Like this video if you learned something. Comment with questions that you have. Be sure and subscribe to this channel so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And until next week, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.